Yuma, welcome to our service this morning. And as we mark the end of Reconciliation Week, we acknowledge the traditional owners, the Ngunnawal people of the land on which we gather and worship and do God's work together. Today is also Pentecost, a day we usually celebrate by reading the story of the first Pentecost from the book of Acts. But this morning we are focusing on the promise of the Holy Spirit that is given in the book of John. The Holy Spirit that is our advocate, our spirit of truth, and the source of our peace. I will light our Christ candle and invite you to sing as our call to worship this morning, O Breath of Love. Let's stand and sing. Please have a seat. Let's pray. Holy Spirit, you poured yourself out on the people of the early church. Pour yourself out on us now. Holy Spirit, you set their tongues on fire with languages so as to speak to one another in ways that could be understood. Set our tongues on fire to speak in different languages and ways so others may hear the good news about Jesus. Jesus, you said you had to go away so that the Holy Spirit, the Advocate, the Spirit of Truth would come, and it was so. Come once again, Holy Spirit, as the advocate that we all need, as the truth teller we all need, as the helper we all need. Come, Holy Spirit, fan your fire, your flames of love and empowerment, set us on fire for you once again, and bring life to our dry bones. Amen. Welcome if you're visiting with us. It is lovely to see some new faces and faces that I have seen before back here. This is the time usually for the children And we don't have too many young ones with us here in the church, but we may have a few watching us on Zoom. So you still get the children's talk, which is good, because I think the adults probably secretly enjoy that best. I have been thinking a bit about birthdays. What do you need for a good birthday, a good birthday party? I don't know why birthdays might have come to mind in this week, for me especially. Hint, hint, hint. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. But I've been thinking about birthdays. What do you need to make a good birthday? People to celebrate it, yes. What else might you need? Cake. Cake is a good thing. I'm also very fond of flowers. No, something else that's sort of birthday-ish. If kids were here, I think they would have said this. Presents, yes, yeah, presents. And balloons. All these things are pretty good. But the one of those. Cake. I actually have lots of cakes. You know, I was hoping that 80 children were going to turn up. But I could be theological. You are all children of God. And there are cupcakes out there. On your way out of church this morning, Steve will be more than happy to help you decorate a cupcake. But I was thinking a bit about birthdays, because normally you do kind of focus on yourself on your birthday, don't you? It's a kind of celebration of you having arrived in the world. But actually, maybe you have to think about where you've arrived and who you've arrived among. Maybe your birthday is also a celebration of the family that you've come to. So on this birthday, I could also give flowers, hint, presents, cake, to my family to say thank you that I get to be part of you, as well as you have me. And perhaps as we think about Pentecost, it is a celebration of each one of us becoming part of God's family, and we are so grateful for each one of you. But it's also a celebration that all of us get to be part of this, God's family together. So I thought we might just sing Happy Birthday. Sorry to throw that at you, Roz. But we might sing it twice. The first time we might sing Happy Birthday, and then the second time we'll sing Happy Birthday to the church. Okay? Happy birthday, dear church. Happy birthday. You get the idea. Happy birthday to you. Let's hear the word of God for us this morning.
I'll be reading from Romans 8, 14 to 17. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. If in fact we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified with him.
The second reading is from John chapter 14, starting at verse 8. Philip said to him, "Lord, show us the Father, and we will be satisfied." Jesus said to him, "Have I been with you all this time, Philip, and you still do not know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'? Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. But if you do not, then believe me because of the works themselves. Very truly I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and in fact will do greater works than these, because I am going to the Father. I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If in my name you ask me for anything, I will do it. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him or knows him. You know him because he abides with you, and he will be in you. I have said these things to you while I am still with you, but the advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid."
For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, for the word of God within us. Thanks be to God. The choir are going to lead us in a song. You're welcome to join in, Da Pacem Domine.
Thank you.
Thank you, James. Thank you, Roz. Thank you, choir. A few weeks ago, we went to a friend's 50th birthday, and when it came time for speeches, she told us a story famously told by Russell Conwell, an American Baptist minister in the late 19th, early 20th centuries, which he, in turn, he says, heard from an Arab guide while he was traveling down the Tigris and Euphrates rivers. The story is about a man of Persian background named Ali Hafed, who owned a farm in south central India. He was a wealthy man and a contented man until one night a traveling Buddhist priest explained to him what diamonds were and how they were made and how valuable they are. They're like congealed drops of sunlight, the monk said. Hafed became obsessed with this idea of finding diamonds and becoming fabulously rich. So he sold his farm to a neighbour, left his family in his care, and travelled the world in search of diamonds until all his money was gone. Finally, broken and heartbroken, he decided to end his life and drowned himself. Conwell comments that at this point his Arab guide stopped and went to assist another camel driver, and he thought to himself, what is the point of this story? It's the first story I've ever heard in which the hero is killed in the first chapter. You too might be wondering where this sermon is headed. But the guide came back and the story continued. One day, the man who had purchased Ali Hafed's farm took his camel to the water to drink. And as his camel put his nose in the water, the man saw something glinting in the sand. He picked up a brightly coloured stone and he took it home and put it on his mantelpiece. A few days later, the monk, now a very old man, visited again, and seeing the stone, was astonished. This is a diamond. Where did it come from? Has Ali Hafed returned? No, said the man. This is from the river on the farm. And this is how the Golconda diamond fields were discovered, a region that has produced some of the world's most famous diamonds, the Kohinoor, the Blue Hope, and the White Regent and Orlov diamonds of the crown jewels of France and Russia. Had Ali Hafed stayed at home and dug in his own garden, instead of travelling to and despairing in and dying in a distant land, he would have had acres of diamonds. The obvious moral is that sometimes what you are looking for, what you desire most, the treasure you seek, is right in front of you, found among the ordinary and the familiar, which is what Jesus says to Philip when Philip says, show us the Father and we will be satisfied. "Have I not been with you all this time, Philip? And you still do not know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father." It is tempting to shake our heads at how obtuse the disciples are and read back into this passage our understanding shaped by centuries of doing theology of the Trinity. That God is one God existing in three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. But in this passage, Jesus is not necessarily referring to an ontological oneness with God, but to a very special, very intimate relationship that he shared with the Father, where the Father's character and will was the source of Jesus' inspiration and authority, but where Jesus subordinated himself to the Father. God is with Jesus. God is in Jesus. God is working through Jesus. "And if you don't believe me, Philip," says Jesus, "that hearing me is hearing God's words, that seeing me is seeing God at work, that knowing me is knowing God, then look at the evidence. Look at what God with me, God in me, God through me is doing. Believe me because of the works themselves." Reminded of the response that Jesus gave to John the Baptist when he sent messengers to ask if Jesus really was the Messiah. The blind receive their sight. The lame walk. The lepers are cleansed. The deaf hear. The dead are raised. And the poor have good news brought to them. God is at work through me. But in this passage, Jesus is also saying goodbye to his disciples. He is preparing them for the time when he will not be with them. So perhaps Philip is not only asking, "Show us the Father," but "Show us how we are to keep going. How we keep doing what you've called us to do when you're gone." And again, Jesus tells them that the treasure they seek is right there with them. If they keep loving Jesus, if they keep obeying his command to love that special and intimate an inspiring and empowering relationship that Jesus shared with God will extend to them and to us. God will be with us. God will be in us. God will be working through us, through the Spirit. The first promise is that the Spirit, or Advocate, now abides with us. Verse 16, "I will ask the Father and he will send you another Advocate to be with you forever." Verse 18, "You know him because he abides with you." The word advocate or parakletos in Greek appears five times in the New Testament, four of those five times in this passage, and has a legal overtone of one who is called to witness for someone or to plead their case or to give advice in a difficult situation. Always, the old commentator William Barclay comments, a parakletos is someone called in to help when the person who calls is in trouble or distress or doubt or bewilderment. That's when you need a parakletos. Older translations use the word comforter. You may have heard the Holy Spirit described as our comforter. But this is because the original meaning of comfort was to make people brave. Comfort comes from the Latin word fortis, brave. Yes, the Holy Spirit is our comforter, but the Holy Spirit also emboldens us and makes us brave. Jesus tells his disciples that now we have two helpers. He will always be advocating for us, and we have another advocate who will come alongside to encourage us, to courage us, to stir us up for the work that God calls us to do. Secondly, we're told that not only will the Spirit be with us, but just as Jesus was in the Father and the Father was in Jesus, the Spirit, verse 17, will be in you. I love that image because it is not only the tongues of fire, but a hand coming around. The Spirit will be in you. G.H. Morling, the Australian Baptist minister, writes in his study on the Holy Spirit, "Surely it awes us to consider that God, the Holy Spirit, enters our inmost heart. And surely it moves us deeply to know that in the secrecy of our inmost heart, we may share with God our loneliness, our troubles, our confessions, our longing." The Holy Spirit coming to us in John's Gospel, Jesus breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit," is a much quieter, much more intimate kind of Pentecost than the one in Acts with the sound of a violent wind and tongues of fire and people proclaiming God's deeds of power in different languages. G.H. Morling describes a time in his student days when he began to seriously seek the Holy Spirit, like the man who desired diamonds. He expected that at some time he would have a spectacular divine visitation, one that would bring a sudden success to his ministry and attract notice. I did not have a divine visitation of that spectacular kind, he writes, but I did have a nervous breakdown because of the intense inner strain. But then a friend shared with him some teaching that he had heard, treasure that was there in front of Morling, that the Spirit of God works firstly on our lives, and then the Spirit of God works in our lives, and finally, the Spirit works through our lives. As it says in John 7, verse 38, out of the believer's heart shall flow rivers of living water. For finally, The promise is that the Holy Spirit is given so we can keep doing the works of Jesus. The one who believes in me, Jesus says, will also do the works that I do, and in fact will do greater works than these because I am going to the Father. And this is the story of the Christian church. That although we know that in many places and in many times it has failed, we also know that in many places and many times God's people have continued to do God's work of love and loving, of liberation and justice. We are called to keep doing this work. And we have so much help to do it. We have a God who shows us what love is. We have Jesus who promises to do anything that we ask for in the name of love. And we have the Holy Spirit with us, in us, and working through us. Going back to my friend's 50th birthday, at the beginning of the night when we arrived, we were asked to identify if we were a camel, a monk, or a diamond. We had to wear a sticker all night with our label on it. And I spent the night in some trepidation that we would eventually have to play some sort of game. But I'm going to ask you, what do you identify most with? Do you feel like you are a camel? Or a monk? Or a diamond? We could do a simple hands up. Hands up for the camels. Who feels like a camel? There's a few camels. Yeah? Who feels like a monk? There's a few monks. I was a monk, confession. Who feels like a diamond? A few diamonds as well. One very enthusiastic diamond down the back. Thank you, John. What my friend said at the end of her speech, and I'm going to adapt it slightly for my sermon, is that if you are a camel, you are the kind of person who gets out there in the world and does stuff. You are prepared to stick your neck out, to be an advocate for others, to come alongside them, just as the Holy Spirit comes alongside us. You do brave things, and in the process, you discover the unimaginable. If you are the monk, people rely on you to share their thoughts and ideas and feelings. Somehow the monk has the capacity to recognize things that others don't and see into them. They're often wise and funny, and being in their presence helps people go deeper as well as turning them out toward the world. And then there are the diamonds. At first, you might look like a lump of ordinary rock, but you are incredibly strong and resilient and ultimately beautiful. And you hold that life and light and energy of God, those congealed drops of sunlight within you, so you can reflect them back into the world. You help all of us to love and to transform the world around us. But perhaps we are all of those things, because the promise of Jesus is that the treasure we seek is here, with us, in us, working through us. In the strong, quiet, and eternal presence of the Holy Spirit that is with us now. Let's sing together. Within our darkest night, you kindle a fire that never dies away. Stand. You are invited to come to this table, knowing that Pentecost will always mean that God's Spirit calls us from our safe upper rooms to go out and speak with strangers. From that kind of birthday cake faith, where the cake is only reserved for us, to a sort of red balloon gospel filled with Christ's example of giving and loving, where the balloons escape our tight fists and float out into all the world. Come to this table where there is bread and wine that will bind us together as the people of God, and send us out to find the people God loves. Let's pray.
We celebrate you this morning, Holy Spirit, hovering over creation and bringing order out of chaos. We praise you, Holy Spirit, filling Jesus with power and wisdom, and through him making life available to all. We welcome you, Holy Spirit, poured out on all people, poured out on us, and leading us into the reign of God. We worship you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. As we gather at this table, we recognize your presence among us and open our hearts to your Spirit's work of love among us and within us. Amen. The Lord Jesus Christ, on the night before his crucifixion and death, gathered his friends for a meal. And during the supper, he took a loaf of bread and gave thanks for it. And then he broke it and passed it among them with these words, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Take, eat, and remember me." And after the meal, Jesus took a cup of wine and gave thanks for it. And then he passed it among them with these words, "This is my blood, which is shed for you. Take, drink, and remember me." We will distribute the bread and then the juice. Please receive and eat the bread when it comes to you. But when the cups are distributed, hold your cup so that we can drink them together as one body in Christ. We eat and we drink to remember Jesus, the love he lived for us and shows us how to live. Let us give thanks together. Let's pray. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for this meal of remembrance and consecration, for coming to us as we have shared it. May the love we find at this table be reflected in our lives. May the power we receive at this table make us peacemakers and healers. May the Spirit who fills us again at this table lead us to be those who proclaim your reign in every word we speak and in every act we do. Amen. Can I invite you to stand before the hymn, and then we are going to sing together. Great Spirit, oh great God, your Spirit fills us. Let's pray. Can I invite you to respond when I say, Holy Spirit,
with the simple two words, help us. Loving God, we ask for the gift of your Holy Spirit to help us pray as we ought. Holy Spirit, help us. We ask for the energy and vision of your Spirit for those who are tiring in the battle against injustice and climate change and oppression, for those exhausted by the struggle with poverty and hunger. Holy Spirit, help us. We ask for the comfort and hope of your Spirit, the courage of your Spirit for those whose lives are overshadowed by illness or pain, for those whose lives are darkened by sorrow or bereavement. Holy Spirit, help us. We ask for the peace and the joy of your Spirit for those now living in the shadow of war and violence. Holy Spirit, help us. We ask for the guidance and strength of your Spirit for those uncertain how to use their time or talents or gifts, and those who are tempted to do what is wrong. Holy Spirit, help us. We ask for the love and courage of your Spirit for those reaching out to comfort the distressed, for those reaching out to share with others your good news. Holy Spirit, help us. Loving God, we ask for the assurance of your Spirit to know your presence with us in our daily lives, in our relationships, in our work and service, in our worship, in our times of joy and pain. Holy Spirit, help us. Amen.
Welcome, everyone. A great time was had at camp last weekend. You wouldn't believe it, but a lot of us swam. And I love watching so many conversations and a deepening of relationships happening all over the campsite. If you'd like to participate next year and you'd like a cabin, you do need to book very soon because they were filling up. So our camp is the 3rd to the 5th of March next year. Wednesday this week from 11 to 1, cooking circles is happening and everyone is very welcome. If you'd like to join, you do need to contact Kirsten by tomorrow. Family church is happening next Sunday, and after family church, there's a family church team planning lunch. The team planning lunch is today. Can you join the community garden to plant some floriade bulbs next Friday? If you're able to help for about an hour next Friday morning, they'd love to see you. Thank you.
We said it down at camp, but I think it really deserves to be said again. Thank you so much to Merrill and so much to Kathy and all the other helpers who stepped in at various points for the church camp, because it really was a wonderful, wonderful weekend. We are so lucky with the weather. Let's give thanks for the gifts that are given in a range of different ways for the work of this church and for further beyond, and especially for our thank offering, which closes today. Loving God, we give you thanks. We give you thanks for your Son, who came to show us your love. And we thank you for your Spirit that remains with us to keep helping us to love as you did. We bring you the gifts that we have given for the work of this church, and we bring you the offerings that have been given for our thank offering to help communities in Bangladesh, especially to help those with disabilities in Bangladesh. And we pray that through our love, they will know your love, they will know our love, they will feel loved. We pray that we will increase in love by having given work, by having given to this work. We give you thanks for these gifts and we just offer them up to your service. In your name, amen. Our final song is "We Will Take What You Offer." Let's stand together. Again, the choir will lead us. Let's stand. Into the world, loving Jesus, obeying his commandment to love, working with the Spirit to bring new life, and speaking of God's goodness in the words of those who would hear. And may the God who breathed life into creation be your delight. May Christ Jesus, who gave hope to your dreaming, may Jesus give hope to your dreaming, and may the Holy Spirit, your advocate and supporter, set your hearts ablaze with the passion for peace. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, amen.